Sri Justice Devan Ramachandran has been associated with Sharda Krishna Sadgamaya Foundation for Law and Justice for decades. His lordship is following the ideals of Justice Krishna Iyer, which can be evidenced in his judgments. In his recent ruling, T.V. Thomas vs. State of Kerala and others, his lordship has ruled that victims of a crime shall not be a mere outsider in the criminal proceedings, but shall be viewed as equal stakeholders in the criminal justice system. This is a pointer towards the direction in which Justice V.R. Krishna has often fought for victimology jurisprudence. I welcome you, sir, to render the presidential address.
The most revered and respected Justice Sri Krishna, friends and family of Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer, ladies and gentlemen. For those of you who are startled to see me standing here, I must say that I am here through a process of virtual transmigration. I am standing by for two very eminent persons, our Honorable Acting Chief Justice, Justice Dominic, and Justice Balakrishnan Nair, who have been unable to come here on account of certain very compelling personal reasons. I know that I'm woefully short, woefully inadequate, even if I try to fill in for their space. But I'm asked to do that as a last-minute replacement. I know that I was not even the first choice to make a replacement. I'm perhaps the last and the only choice. If the sheen and glory of this function is in any manner diminished on account of my substitution, I start with an apology. Though I say that I was completely short and insufficient, I feel that. I was searching whether I could possibly claim some credentials to be here today. I didn't have to search far. I am one of those persons who can proudly say that I've spent my entire life till 2014 in the blessing and the umbrella of Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer. Justice Anu and I, we have the privilege of being the children of the juniors of Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer. Her father and my father were his juniors, and we therefore became in default sub-juniors to Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer, and we have always been under his umbrella of protection. So, possibly one of the persons here to say that I know him ever since my birth, that would possibly be the credential that I draw for myself to be here. So when Sahasranaman and Pradeep asked me to stand by yesterday, I was perturbed. I was not sure whether I should do that at all. But then this is one reason why I thought it's an opportunity. So I'm here by accident. But then I should say that it is a great blessing for me, because this way, completely unexpectedly, I've got the opportunity of sharing the dais with none other than Justice Sri Krishna. I never thought I would get this opportunity ever in my life. Never, ever. Thank you very much for that, sir. I've always thought what Justice Krishna really stood for us. Who was he for us? It defies description. I do not know how to describe him. Was he my father? Yes, he was. Was he my grandfather? Yes, he was, to all of us. Was he our guru? Yes, certainly he was. He was the light that guided us. And when we think of a guru, we always think of the Sanskrit adage, Mata Pita Guru Devam. As youngsters, we were told that this is the order of reverence that we give first mother, then father, then guru, and then Devam. But as I grew up, I thought, when I was seeing Justice Krishna Iyer in close quarters, he was more than all this to me. He was part of the cosmic force. And I thought of this adage, Mata Pita Guru Devam. I know that I'm speaking in front of a foremost expert, but then I take the liberty. It is not the order of reverence. It's a constituent of the whole. It's a constituent of the cosmic whole. Your mother and father are your first teachers, and then is your formal teacher, the guru. Just imagine if you take the last syllable of each of these words, Mata, take the A out of it. Pita, take the A out of it. Guru, take the U out of it. And Devam, take the M. You say it together, you get Om. That's the Pranava mantra. So for us, just as Krishna was Pranava, he was our Pranava. He was our everything. As a child, I remember, it used to be perturbing for me to even go to the presence of Justice Krishna. His presence was so overwhelming that it was really scary. And it was during the last 8 or 9 years of his life that I had the opportunity, when my father fell ill, and I'm always standing by, stood by for him. Every evening, I had that 5 or 10 minutes every evening before Justice Krishna went to sleep. It changed us. Just saying that this is what Krishna meant for many of us here, for most of us here, or for all of us here. It was always thought that he was the emperor of hearts of people. He was a man who never thought of walking the primrose path. He abjured the easy path. He walked the path less taken. And this is what he has inspired us. That 5 or 6 years I spent with him in the evenings, just 5 minutes every evening, changed me so much that, believe me, I'm a different person today. So this was the inspiration. And this is the same inspiration that took us to create this foundation. This foundation was created when he was alive, at least 10 or 12 years before he was alive. And it was always his presence and his blessings that took us through. Suddenly on the 4th of December 2015, I'm sorry, 14, when Justice Krishna Iyer left us, we felt orphaned. We did not know what to do. We had no idea where we were. We felt as if our steps in front of us were fading. We were literally rudderless. That was the kind of presence he had. Even today, I remember those days when he was alive. Sami, as we called him, he was Swami for us. He was not Justice Krishna, he was Swami for us. He would be sitting there where I am sitting. Imagine where I've been sitting today. I can't even imagine. He would be sitting there with his eyes half closed, with a quizzical smile on his face, pretending to be oblivious to everything. And when the function is almost over, there was that 5 or 10 minutes that was reserved for him customarily to give the closing remarks. And that would become the hallmark of the function. We miss him so much today. And I'm such a poor substitute. I don't know. I really do not know how I was thought to be the substitute. Now coming to the foundation, we visualize this and actualize this. This is his juniors, including my father, who had the brainstorm to create this foundation. Believe us, this foundation was something that we created for the purpose of the memory of Justice Krishna Iyer much after he would not be there. We never knew that he would go away so soon. Though he lived for 100 years, we never thought he would go away so soon. We really did not. He was hospitalized on the 20th of November 2014, or 21st of November 2014. And like every time he was hospitalized, we would think that he would just come back walking, smiling, back to his house. But this time it was never to be. On the 4th of December, he gave up his fight. I think in these times, when a lot of things are happening, I do not want to specify anything. If you have to go for guidance, if you have to go for the light, I always think, where do we go? And I sometimes feel, if only I could see him once more. If only I could sit with him once more. If only I could ask him once more. The foundation began as a search for truth. That's why it's called the Sadgamaya. Sadgamaya was Justice Krishna's residence. Or it is his residence even now. Sadgamaya, of course, as you know, came out of the Pavamana mantra of the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad in Yajurveda. Sadgamaya means light, lead to light. Asatoma Sadgamaya, Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya, Mrityoma Amritam Gamaya. This was Krishna for us. This was Swami for us. He led us from darkness to light, from deception to truth, from death to immortality. Not death of physical form, death of the character. I wonder if he had been alive today, it would have been so different. That being said, I'm sorry I'm taking so much of time, really sorry. That being said, we are really fortunate today. It is our greatest blessing that we have somebody, it's a personality of the stature, to whom everything that I spoke about Krishna would fit immaculately. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Justice Bellur Narayana Swami Sri Krishna. I believe that his lordship is now the chairman of the Financial Sector Legislative Reforms Commission. His lordship became a judge of this court in 1990. I'm sorry, a judge in the year 1990. I'm saying this for a particular reason. I'm also a new judge. I've just put in 14 months now. Just about three years after his lordship took over as a judge, his lordship was asked to head the Sri Krishna Commission. Not a small task for a young judge. And what was he asked to investigate and to examine? The Bombay riots. Subject to correction, I have been told that this was an offer that was made to senior judges and they refused. So this is why I said, I see in Justice Sri Krishna everything that I saw in Justice Krishna, my Swami. The courage, the intellectual capacity. His lordship was our Chief Justice here in 2001. I was a lawyer with about 10 years of practice or less. He doesn't remember me now. Perhaps I looked different, sir. But, sir, I'll tell you one thing. Your smile could disarm the most belligerent lawyer. And his intellectual capacity would silence us. His lordship's post-retirement attributes are also equally magnanimous. I'm not saying anything further on that. I'm only saying that we are really blessed and we deem ourselves most blessed that you are here with us today, sir. Thank you very much. And we cannot think of a better commemoration to the memory of our great Swami. Thank you for coming, sir. Thank you very much.
Dear brother Devan Ramachandran, who is presiding over today's function, Mr. Sahasranam, and the others who are the leading lights of the Tamaso, of the Sadgamaya, Sharada Sadgamaya Foundation, Brother Sirya, past colleagues of mine, be sitting behind. When we go to a cricket match, sometimes some player has a problem, he gets injured or something of the sort. So they bring in a substitute at the last time. But what a pleasant surprise it is when the substitute hits out a century without hesitation. That's what dear brother Devan Ramachandran did today. Yes, a power of attorney as a substitute, but he excelled himself. Now to talk about the paradigm of social justice. Valmiki Maharshi in his Ramayana said, Ramo Vigrahavan Dharmaha. By that he meant that Sri Rama was the embodiment of all that was conceptualized in the principles of Dharma. When we turn to the legal system in England, which we inherited from the British, we find that there is a common convention of referring to the judges of the superior courts, namely the High Court, the Supreme Court, as justice. If you look at it, grammatically, justice is an abstract noun. It is not a common noun which can be addressed to somebody, nor is it an adjective in that sense. So when somebody is called justice, the same Vigrahavan Dharmaha is the concept that is behind that. That he embodies justice, he has absorbed all the ethical concepts of justice, and he implements it in his conduct. That is why a judge is called justice I'm not very sure as to how many in the present context in today's world would be entitled to be properly called justices in the sense in which I just described. But if there is one person to whom hesitation at any time and at all times, that was the late Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer, who was till recently a living legend in the realm of law. It is said that the character of a human being is molded by the social circumstances in which the human being is brought up. Justice Krishna Iyer was born in the year 1915 in the Malabar region of the then Madras state. The contemporary social milieu prevalent at that time must have left a deep-seated impression on his mind during his childhood. What he saw all around was widespread feudalism with rich landlords acting as exploiters of the laborers and the tillers of land. Having witnessed free exploitation, the child in Justice Krishna Iyer was towards exploitation of human being by human beings. When the last grew up and pursued education, he towards law as that best suited his temperament and urges and could afford him an opportunity of rectifying a number of social inequalities to which he was witness. After having qualified in law, he put his legal knowledge to defend the cause of peasants and workers and to protest and fight against the iniquities against them and their exploitation by feudal lords. As a young man, he was influenced by the prevalent Marxist thinking to which he was naturally attracted. His frequent acts of protest and defense of exploited labor brought upon him the wrath of the feudal landlords and the colonial government which supported them. He therefore suffered at the hands of the police and was arrested. That gave him an insight into the methods used by police while implementing the criminal law and also gave him first-hand experience of what the police really does. Having suffered at the hands of police and the oppressive state machinery, he rebelled against it and vigorously pursued his legal practice, voicing strong protest and dissent against what he considered to be offensive to humanitarian values. The elections to the Madras Legislative Assembly gave him an opportunity to ventilate the grievances of the oppressed sections of society before the legislature. He was elected to the Madras Legislative Assembly in 1966 and thereafter, after the reorganization of states, to the Kerala Legislative Assembly. The vim and vigor displayed by him in his role as a legislator resulted in his being selected as to be appointed as a minister in charge of law of several important portfolios like law, social welfare, and so on. His role as a minister in charge of several portfolios gave him an insight into the nuances of governance and administration of the state. Getting an insider view, he realized the imbalance in the relation between the state and the citizens. Pursuing his vision of a society sun, he became the draftsman of the Kerala Land Reforms Act, which is reckoned as the forerunner of land of all land reform legislation in this country. Having seen the legislative machinery from the inside, and having had a driver's view of the executive machinery, now it was to adorn their seat in the judicial apparatus of the state. He was appointed a judge of the Kerala High Court in 1968. During 71 to 73, he, coupled with the compassionate nature and accent on human rights, enabled him to be associated with national and international organizations dealing with socio-legal issues. The judgments, a judge is known by his judgments more than what he talks elsewhere. The judgments rendered by Justice Krishna Iyer as a judge of the Kerala High Court doubtless redound to his mastery of forensic finesse and flawless jurisprudence. But what distinguishes them is that they are imbued with that human quality which is twice blessed, to wit, the quality of mercy. His decisions are tempered with compassion and humanitarian. His role as a judge of the Kerala High Court, the beginning of his ascent on his judicial career, which culminated in his being appointed as a judge of the Supreme Court of India in the year 1973. Very few people seldom practice what they preach. Fewer still get the opportunity to implement the principles which they hold high and vociferously articulate. Justice Krishna Iyer was singularly fortunate that both as judge of the Kerala High Court and as a judge of the Supreme Court, he was given a God-sent opportunity to employ his mettle to implement the principles of social justice, distributive justice, and human rights that were always dear to him. Wherever there was injustice which cried for remedy, Justice Krishna Iyer could be seen rushing on his white charger of social justice, jousting with the oppressive forces in society, which, unlike in the case of Don Quixote of Cervantes, were the real dragons afflicting society. He flashed his jurisprudential Excalibur to slay the monsters of misery and pain afflicted on the poor and the oppressed. Krishna Iyer's judicial activism was neither contrived nor put on. For him, it was innate, like the Kundala and the Kavacha of Karna, who is extolled as a Danashura in the Mahabharata. With his unerring instinct of discovering where the nub of a case lay, he would unravel the Gordian knot of any case and expound his in reasoning couched in felicitous phraseology. The learned judge rendered judgments which, while alleviating the misery and suffering of an unfortunate litigant, also enriched our legal literature in the country. His judgments afford and provide an aperçu into the depth of his knowledge and width of learning in legal and non-legal literature. He was a master of inventing new words when required to suit the Indian temperament. His genius lay in assimilating all that was best in the inherited legal system from England and applying and blending it to the Indian situations as required. He was wont to say often that our legal and political system represents a cross-fertilization of Thames and Ganga, meaning that it represents the best in the British system blended with the Indian genius. Greek mythology tells us that King Midas of the royal house of Phrygia had a special quality of turning all that he touched into gold. Such was the Midas touch of Justice Krishna Iyer that every branch of law that he dealt with received a distinct imprint of his judicial genius. His pioneering spirit left gasping those with high ideas of law. He reveled in transforming legal ideas of past centuries into instruments of emancipation to be used in the 20th century. He was scathing on the way our legal system operates to the prejudice of the oppressed sections of society when he observed, and I'm quoting, "Our legal system, including the police, is anti-Dalit and anti-poor," unquote. In the famous Ratlam municipality case, Krishna Iyer sowed the seeds of what has now become public interest litigation. He boldly declared that the municipality, being a public body, was answerable to the citizens in the discharge of its constitutional duties of ensuring that the citizens were not subjected to pollution resulting in danger to their health. Although the cause before the learned arose only out of a civil suit, the wise judge laid down the fundamentals of administrative law and declared that the municipality exists for the public and not vice versa. Perhaps This was also the forerunner of the polluter pays principle, which was adopted and articulated much later by our Supreme Court. I may be justified in calling Justice Krishna Iyer as the spearhead of gender equality and gender justice, which are buzzwords in today's world. In Muthamma's case, he came out boldly that a rule in the Indian Forest Service, which discriminated against women officers, was bad and afoul of the constitutional doctrine enshrined in Article 14 of non-discrimination on the basis of gender. Though not talking in terms of breaking the glass ceiling, he did precisely that and advanced the cause of women in society. In criminal jurisprudence, Justice Krishna's ideas brought a breath of fresh air, being always imbued with compassion towards the accused who were subjected to indiscriminate torture in the hands of the investigating agency and underwent long probation without bail. His clarion call, "Bail is the rule and jail the exception," has remained the byword for generations of judges who deal with matters of bail. His observation in Moti Ram's case are worth recounting. The learned judge very critically said, and I quote, "The hornet's nest of part 3 need not be provoked if we read bail to mean it popularly does, and in American jurisprudence is stated to mean, namely, a generic expression used to describe judicial release from custodia juris. Bearing in mind the need for liberal interpretation in areas of social justice, individual freedom and indigent rights, we hold that bail covers both release on one's own bond with or without sureties. When sureties should be demanded and what sum should be insisted on are dependent on variables," unquote. Recognizing that in a poor country like India, an accused may not be able to furnish securities or bail in monetary terms, he said, "Even so, poor men, Indians, are in monetary terms indigents. Young persons, infirm individuals, and women are weak categories, and courts should be liberal in relying on their own recognizance, put whatever reasonable conditions." It was his firm conviction that criminal justice system should not become hostage to rich accused who can afford to furnish bail and or provide surety bonds, nor should it look down on the class of persons belonging to weaker sections of society. The wise judge believed neither in the theory of retribution nor vindication in the punishment of wrongdoers. He was a strong votary of the manner in which the American courts had dealt with justice delivery system in criminal matters, and was keen that the Indian criminal justice system should also adopt the reformatory methods. He was a strong votary of abolition of the death penalty, for his spiritual tendencies overtook him in this aspect, and he contended that those who cannot give life, cannot take life. He said, "The death penalty law's wrathful majesty in bloodshot equality deals the fatal blow on the poor, not the rich, the pariah, not the Brahmin, the black, not the white, the underdog, not the top dog, the dissenter, not the conformist," unquote. His coup de grace is, "The law barks at all, but bites only the poor, the powerless, the illiterate, the ignorant." It is well known spirit. Krishna Iyer's remarkable quality of blending invisibles led him to strong spiritual beliefs despite his grounding in Marxist theories. His spiritual qualities came to the fore with advancing age and particularly became prominent after the passing away of his dear wife, whom he held in great esteem. He was often heard to remark that he could communicate with his dear departed wife Sharada on a spiritual plane. When we look at the field of administrative law, Justice Iyer's emphasis on the rule of law is clearly visible in scores of cases. He always deprecated the hubris in power, hubris of the of those in power, and humbled them when the occasion demanded. In the unequal fight between a poor litigant and the powerful executive, he ensured that justice was rendered by deft wielding of the constitutional cutlass. Justice Krishna Iyer's greatest contribution to law is the manner in which he humanized justice. His observations in Hussein Ali Khatam case, Sunil Batra, and a host of other cases are evidence of his deep-seated values of what he used to call human jurisprudence. In Inder Singh's case, while dealing with the great grant of parole under the Code of Criminal Procedure 1973, he took the view that the state government must implement the concerned rules of parole for human treatment, ensuring curative strategy and human dignity. In his view, parole was not merely a matter of insensitive application of the rules, but called for a sympathetic and humane treatment of the prisoners. In Shivshankar Dal Mills, he expounded on the writ jurisdiction under Article 26 to include a flexible power in the court as the public interest and equity of the occasion demanded. In this view, he directed the state to return what had been wrongly recovered. Human activist in Justice Iyer led him to decry and deprecate the provisions in the Civil Procedure Code which enabled an undischarged debtor to be subjected to civil imprisonment. In Varghese's case, he condemned this provision of law as reminiscent of the antiquated ideas of the Dickensian era, unfit to be advocated in the current century. When it came to the rights of labor, Krishna Iyer's judgments are nonpareil. His judgment in the Bangalore Border case is a locus classicus and a monument to his acute sense of social justice. In one fell swoop, he expanded the concept of industry for attracting the provisions of the Industrial Disputes Act 1947. In his thinking, the concept of industry would apply across the board to charities, educational institutions, hospitals, member clubs, and a host of other organized activities which were hitherto not recognized as industry and resulted in depriving the workers of their benefits due under the welfare legislations. He postulated only one exception to the rule and pointed out that an entity which was run by a baker, butcher or candlestick maker with a marginal or negligible participatory activity by workmen could only be the solitary exception to the general rule. To Mr. Justice Krishna Iyer, the Supreme Court was much more than a court of law. In Srimati Baigana and others, he observed, and I quote, "The Supreme Court is more than a court of appeal. It exercises power only when there is a supreme need. It is not the fifth court of appeal, but the final court of the nation. Therefore, even if legal flaws may be electronically detected, we cannot interfere some manifest injustice on substantial questions of public importance." By this token, the petitioner has missed the bus, dismissed. How one devoutly wishes that all successive judges had followed his principle in admitting special leave petitions in the exercise of jurisdiction under Article 136 and saved themselves and scores of other judges from the oppressive burden of special leave petitions on each Monday and Friday. Courts are very astute when it comes to interpreting pleadings of parties. Taking exception to the manner in which pleadings are construed generally, the learned judge in S.B. Narona's case observed, and I quote, "It is well settled that pleadings are loosely drafted in this country, and the court should not scrutinize the pleadings with such meticulous care so as to result in genuine claims being defeated on trivial grounds," unquote. Obviously, the learned judge was articulating and implementing the oft-repeated adage that procedure is just the handmaiden of justice. Stung by the brazenness with which the government of Punjab had rejected the licenses for cycle rickshaw pullers under a scheme formulated by the state, the learned judge in Azad Rickshaw case observed, and I quote, "The state, by exercising its legislative power alone, could not produce justice until this formula was hammered out. the court with its process of justice alone could not produce a valuable project. But now justice and power have come together, and hopefully we have fulfilled the words of Blaise Pascal: justice without power is inefficient, power without justice is tyranny. Justice and power must therefore be brought together, so that whatever is just may be powerful, and whatever is powerful may be just." Unquote. Sitting on a constitutional bench in the case of Ambika Prasad Mishra, the learned judge reiterated the doctrine of precedence and observed, and this is very important, "Every new argumentative novelty cannot undo it. Fatal flaws already dealt by earlier rulings cannot survive, and decision does not lose force on the ground that it was badly argued or inadequately considered." Unquote. Dealing with the grant of maintenance to a Muslim wife who was subject to talaq, in Fuzlunbi's case, the learned judge says, "That payment of illusory amount does not annihilate the rate, and that there must be rational relation between the sum so paid and the amount of maintenance." When one reads so many judgments rendered by the illustrious judge in several branches of law, one cannot but be struck by the thread of his concern for compassion, human values, and human jurisprudence running through each one of them. Each one of his judgments is inspired by a burning sense of social justice and keenness to tilt the balance in favor of the meek, the poor, the oppressed, and the helpless. The very purpose of law has been declared in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad as "Tadetat kshatrasya kshatram yad dharmaha yasmat param nasti atho abaliyan baliyam sam ashamsate." The Brihadaranyaka Upanishad declares that dharma, which we may translate as law for our present purpose, is the kshatrasya kshatram, is the king of kings. He says, therefore, there cannot be anything higher than that, the concept of rule of law which we adopt, namely, however high you are, the law is above you. And finally, ato abaliyan baliyam samashamsate. This is the principle by which the weak can challenge the mightiest. Now, see what is happening every day in the courts of law. Article 226, Article 32 allow us, a petition, a rickshaw puller or a person sleeping on the street, to challenge the mightiest of the mighty, namely the governments at both the state and the center, the prime minister and the president all included. This is exactly what was envisioned by Justice Iyer. He used the law in favor of those who were subjected to injustice on account of social, legal, and economic circumstances prevalent in society to tilt against the powerful, influential, and rich oppressors. God, in his infinite mercy, was bountiful in the matter of lifespan bestowed on the learned judge. He lived almost to a full span of 100 years, dedicated to service of humanity in the cause of justice, social, economic, and political, as envisioned in the preamble to our constitution. The oath which he took when appointed as a minister, as a judge of the High Court, and as a judge of the Supreme Court, to uphold the constitution and the laws made under it, and to render justice to all and his all in accordance with his judicial conscience, without fear or favor, continued to remain with him, not only during his judicial career, but even beyond, until his last breath. In the Mahabharata, Bhishma had the power of deciding unto himself as to when he would shuffle off his mortal coil. I wonder if Justice Krishna had this venerable power of deciding his own date of departure. He was also renowned for his ideals of dharma, earning him the epithet of Bhishma Pitamaha. Justice Iyer is also known as the Bhishma Pitamaha of the Indian legal system, not merely because of the number of years of his association with law, but also because of the high values in the lifeblood of law and the manner in which he molded the law to suit the genius of the Indian people and to render social justice to them. Now, if I may be permitted to strike two personal notes on this occasion, with which I think I must talk about. One was, I was a very young man, probably not very young, young compared to what I am today. During my bar days, appearing in the Supreme Court, and I was told, I was appearing for an employer, I was told that I was up against a deadly bench. What did the deadly bench consist of? It consisted of Justice Krishna Iyer, Justice Chinnappa Reddy, and Justice D.A. Desai. Any of you who have read judgments will know that it was the death knell of an employer's case. So when you are young, you are rash. So I said, what does it matter? I'm sure I can persuade them. So I walked into the court, and Justice D.A. Desai looked at me and said, don't you know that you are in the wrong court? I looked at the call list and said, sorry, I'm in the right court. He said, no, you represent an employer, and this is not a court for employers. So I said, fine. I said, permit me to make my submissions. So I started making permissions. And believe me, this is where I appreciate this sense of balance, this sense of social justice in real sense. Because of Justice Krishna Iyer, I can't say that I succeeded hands down, but he brought a sense of mellowness into the arguments, and ultimately he gave me almost 50% of the relief that I was asking for, despite the deadly bench, as we used to call them during my bar days. His sense of justice did not allow his other compatriot judges to just throw me away like that. He allowed me to argue, persisted in questioning the other side counsel, and found a midway path which really did justice to both sides. Another incident which I must narrate, which gave me a clearest insight into the psyche of the great judge. This is after I had changed into the avatar of a judge, and I was actually the Chief Justice here. When I was the Chief Justice in Kerala, I think it was the year 2001 sometime, I was invited to attend a seminar in Delhi on justiciability of socio-economic rights. I went, till then I did not, apart from the fact that I looked at him from the other side of the bar, I did not have any opportunity of even saying hello to Justice Krishna Iyer, because I was still a small man and he was a big judge. So when I went to this conference, I was escorted by somebody who told me Justice Krishna Iyer is there. I said, I would like to pay my respect to him. So I went there, and I was taken to a chair where a venerable gentleman in white mundu and white half-sleeve shirt was sitting there. And I said, I'm so and so. What do you think he did? He just got up, embraced me, and he said, you did wonderful work in the Civil Rights Commission. And he said, I can't expect anything better than any other judge. And he started crying. I said, this man has social justice in every cell of his body. Because that was the appreciation. And he also said, I am Krishna, you are Krishna, but you are Sri Krishna. And he started crying. I thought that was really touching to me. And I realized that this was the nature of the human being. When I stood before him and introduced myself, I was struck dumb when he promptly stood up, embraced me, and commended me on the work done by me in the Bombay Riots Commission. What immensely touched me was that he had tears in his eyes when he said the kind words to me. That, more than any of the judgments rendered by him, convinced me to believe that the Honorable Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer had social justice in his thoughts, words, and deeds, and was a true paradigm of social justice. Ladies and gentlemen, I may conclude by telling you an episode from Ramayana. In the Ramayana, there is a challenge to Anjaneya's bhakti. So somebody challenges him. So Anjaneya does a simple thing. He closes his eyes, pulls out one hair from his body, and gives it to Narada. I think Narada challenges him. He says, you just put it to your ear and see. He puts it to ear, and that strand of hair keeps on saying, Sri Ram, Sri Ram, Sri Ram. So if somebody did that to Justice Krishna here, it would say, social justice, social justice, social justice. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.